All right, you're good to go.
Well, welcome to the December 15th, 2020 session of Tangerine SDR and HamSci Personal Space Weather Station Zoom session. My name is Dave, KV0S, and this week I've been helping Dave. We're running similar software, and he keeps upgrading versions, and I keep trying to keep up with his versions. So we're both running version 14 of his code right now, unless he's got a 15 yet.
I will soon.
Okay. And so that's mostly it. Been finishing up classes, so that also took a little bit of time, and then helping my wife with some of her health issues, so we're keeps me busy. Anyway, next on the list we have Nathaniel, W2NAF. Go ahead, Nathaniel.
Thank you very much, Dave. I've just been continuing moving along here. This week I'm starting to write up the annual reports for the grants. And so I'm starting to do the DAISY grant one. I've started that one today. So I may reach out to some of you and ask for some information to include in the report. So I will let you know this week as I do that, because I have to try and include all the names of the people who've helped out with different things. And you know, I greatly appreciate all that. Otherwise, I'm also working on AGU, American Geophysical Union meeting, and getting the HamSci workshop put together for next year too.
Back to Matt. Next on the list, we have Dave Witten, KD0EAG. Go ahead, Dave.
Hello. Yes, I've been working on the, well, I meant to be working on the more user-friendly version of the testing code, but in fact, I've been dragged back into the earlier version to get some things squared away, and so I'm going to have to start the forward fork of it over again, and I'll do it all over. But but it seems to be working as best I can tell, the way my correspondents are wanting it to. And that, so if we have some confidence in this, I'll be getting some other code that I would really recommend people use very shortly. Without so much gunk in it. So that's what I've been doing. Back over to you, Dave.
Fine business. And next on the list, we have John Gibbons. Go ahead, John.
It's been a very busy week. I shipped three stations to Nathaniel, which he should have received today. Yes or no?
I got an email saying that there's a box in my mailbox on campus.
Okay, you got it.
Now I have to get myself out of my house, into my car, onto campus.
I ship it if you want it, so.
But it's snowing outside.
Oh, okay. That's a good excuse. Today I'm putting the wraps on four more complete low-cost personal space weather stations. I've got two of them calibrated. The third one, I just started the cal about 5 minutes ago. They take about 2 to 3 hours to go for a first pass. And I got one more ready to cal once that's done. And then I got two more in the wings that are hopefully going to be. I have four more people on the list, which I have to figure out who they are at this point. I haven't looked at the list. But the fifth one, I'm thinking I want to send to Bill Engelke, because he really needs to have a system to have access to for his code creation. And he really should have the real thing in his hands. So all you need is an antenna and a wall outlet and a Ethernet connection. So that's all you should need. It's a whole radio and everything. So, but I've been working busily. It takes me, I don't know, 10 hours per system. So I've gotten six done and I got four more to go. So back to net.
Very good. Next on the list is Bill Engelke, AB4EJ. Go ahead, Bill.
Thanks, Dave. Good evening to you and good evening to the net. Uncharacteristically, I have really not been that busy this week. I've been working on a few other things unrelated to this project, but I have been playing around a little bit with the GNU interconnection with the local host, and we discovered, and Tom McDermott helped me figure this out, that the I and Q samples coming from the Flex radio are reversed. So it sends you imaginary and then real rather than the other way around. And I understand that that is probably to keep it compatible with OpenHPSDR because that radio uses the same convention. So we'll just have to make sure that we figure that out and maybe give people a button or a control where they can switch it back and forth depending upon what software they want to use and things like that. But anyway, so I have been playing around a little bit with trying to generate some of the type of charts that Steve Serwin has generated that show very nicely the Doppler shift at sunrise and sundown. So I have a few crummy examples of that. I'm still trying to get the color scheme right so it's not all washed out so you can actually see what you're looking at, some things like that. So anyway, that's what's going on here. Back to Ned.
Fine business. And next on the list, we have Dan in for XWE. Go ahead, Dan.
Okay, thank you, Dave, and hello, everyone. I'm still struggling a little bit with computer stuff, and I'm up on the Pi again tonight, so my video is somewhat limited, but I think the audio is pretty good. Anyway, I received a red pitaya from Scotty a couple weeks ago, and I have it up and running. Seems to be working pretty well. I've also kind of put my GitHub repository online. I have 7 scripts. They're all Raspberry Pi scripts at present. There's GNU Radio. There's WSJTX. There's Pi HPSDR. A couple of versions of FL Digi. And I think in the next couple of days, I'll also have 3 or 4 scripts up for the Odroid N2. I've written them, but I haven't had a chance to do QA on them yet. So when I get that done, I'll put them up and anyone is welcome to use them. It's repository is basically my call sign on GitHub. So it's been a little bit of a learning curve with GitHub. I know Git fairly well, but GitHub is kind of a GUI interface to Git. And it does all the same things, but it does them a little differently. So anyway, back to you, Dave.
Well, fine business. And you know you can use regular Git to get to your GitHub space once you've set it up, right?
Yes, I do know that.
Okay. And next on the list, let's see, Dave Mack in 1HAC, right? Go ahead,
Hello.
Dave.
Got my name up just in time. Well, good evening, everyone. Been doing a bunch of things. Working on our AM Doppler system, our SDR that's hopefully going to Baffin Island, and a VLF receiver for a rocket project. So very busy these days. Back to net.
Well, fine business. And then next on the list is Dev. Dev, we haven't talked to you for a bit, and we had to pass over you because we had such a long discussion the other night. Go ahead.
Oh, that's fine. That's completely fine. So I'm doing well. And we have been looking through the ionograms that we have made out of the data received at Nathaniel's house. And we would be going through those data a little more carefully to set the questions that we would like to ask.
Okay.
And if we have time, I think I'm still in the queue.
Okay. And next on the list, we have Dick, K2LCT. Go ahead, Dick.
Okay, Dave, I hope you can copy me. I have nothing to report today. Thanks for picking me up. Over.
Okay, very good. And next on the list is Gary, AF8A. Go ahead, Gary.
Good evening, everyone. Nothing to report here. Just sorry to hear that it's snowing in Scranton, Nathaniel, but we had 18 or 20 inches here a couple of weeks ago. So I'm glad Mother Nature is spreading around.
I'm actually kind of jealous. I like snow.
All right, back to that.
Well, I did see there's a big swath of snow across the Northeast on the prediction.
I'm looking forward to it. And I want an excuse to buy a snowmobile. So
you should instead congratulate us.
Yes.
What you may need actually is a snow blower and some cross-country skis.
The cross-country skis are coming, but I definitely want a snowmobile. The snow blower, I don't need that.
I think we're
well. Yeah, I mean, if all you need to do is go places by snowmobile, you can do that. You don't need a snow blower.
Yeah.
So Nathaniel, didn't you have one in Svalbard or something?
I did, but I had to sell it after. After I was gone, I had to sell it. So, but when I was there, I did own a snowmobile for about 6 months or a year or so.
Well, that's good.
I got to zip all around the Arctic.
You should get the snowmobile with the snowblower attachment.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, we're supposed to be just outside the snow shield here, a little too far away from the coast. But looking forward to some snowshoeing at some time.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be tough in Cleveland.
Let's go on with the list. And I believe the next one on the list is Jonathan, KC3EEY. Go ahead, Jonathan.
Hi, everybody. I don't have much to report. I've been reviewing the designs of my VLF receivers that I started back in 2014, E field and B field receivers and the optical audio links that I wanted to try with them. I've also been going over some of my seismic sensor projects as well. Other than that, I don't have much to report. Back to the net.
Fine business. Next on the list, we have Mike, AA8K. Go ahead, Mike.
Thank you, Dave. Greetings to everyone on the conference. Still collecting eclipse data. Back to you, Dave.
Very good. Next on the list is Scotty, WA2DFI. Go ahead, Scotty.
Okay, thanks, Tom. Dave. I'm thinking Tom is the only one left because he's always after me, no matter how late I check in here.
Yeah.
So not a lot happening this week. So a forest fire that almost put out here. And then pretty much the rest of the year is going to be devoted to tangerines. So I'll hopefully have some good stuff to report. And it's a cold wave here, by the way, guys. It's going to be 37 tonight. And I know you're all going to whine about, but so I'll tell you, it'll be 62 tomorrow. So it'll be really nice. We won't no snowball fights here. So have one for me, Nathaniel. Go, take yourself all right out and have a his first snowball fight, right?
Maybe that's first. Great.
Don't
he loves
you just
it.
Have to go to the other end of your state to get snow?
Yeah, yeah.
If we you can go to that. The north?
Yeah, go to the north. In fact, I think we had rain on Thursday, and that's usually a sign that in Flagstaff they have snow, so they probably got a bunch of it up there.
Go skip you some.
Yeah. Hey, you know, I've seen guys drive up to Flagstaff. It's 125, 130 miles away. They pack their pickup bed full of snow and they drive back down to Phoenix. They have a snowball fight in their front yard.
Oh. That's wonderful.
That's decadence for you.
Yeah. Well, next on the list is Tom McDermott in 5EG. Go ahead, Tom.
Okay, not much. Just seems like a lot of support emails and support phone calls this week, but only a little bit related to the project. Back to net.
Fine business. So we're open for a general discussion. And Dev had something to present the other night. Dev, do you want to present a little of that?
Okay, so I take the precedence.
Yep, you're in the queue.
Okay, so let me try to share the screen, and I was not prepared, so it may take a little while, few seconds to exactly get to the page. Maybe not, okay, I may have it, okay. So we process good data, and we got ionograms like these. Okay. So these are after running UHA's job sounder package in our Ubuntu system at Nathaniel's house. And there are many other ionograms received from many other locations, but I filter the data only to look for the ones, look for signals coming from Virginia. So these are the kind of ionograms I have. So I'll show the movie for these ionograms for a couple of days. And maybe that should be it. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then I guess I'll ask a technical question of the group.
Okay. So this is for 16.
Anyone know what the high frequency stuff is above 9 megahertz?
Ethan, Phil Erickson tells me that Ethan Miller tells him that that is Su scatter.
C scatter?
Yes. That's what Phil Erickson tells me that Ethan Miller tells him. But we're going to have a little group discussion on Friday where we'll get to look at this
is together. That, oh, I see the scatter?
this one.
It's in C, the letter C is in Charlie, or SEA, the coming
S-E-A.
Off the
SEA.
SEA, off so of the it, waves.
Yeah, off
okay. The waves. SEA, which may mean ocean as well, okay? So this is
so where's the transmitter on this one?
Transmitter is Virginia over the horizon radar, OTHR.
I see.
The Rother radar, the relocatable over the horizon radar.
So we can see this is local time. I have here local time, 8:46 a.m. So generally the ion sphere. Let me go back. I'm starting after the middle midnight, 10 minute. So it's very low frequency. So what I have observed so far, between 3 and 4, like 3 and 4, I have good spread. So during my graduate research, I mostly worked in equatorial ionosphere, and in equatorial ionosphere, in low latitude ionosphere, there is something called as post-midnight irregularities. So I don't know like if the similar phenomena exist in mid-latitude. So, but I see this feature consistently every night. Between 3 to 4 a.m. in the morning, these traces get very spread. That's one, let us say, very dumb observation, okay? If not, it reduces, maybe recombines around six. When it goes to 6:30 a.m., 7 a.m., 7:15 a.m., the ion spray starts building up, maybe due to sunrise. So it increases as we see. 7 a.m. it's increasing. So it goes on increasing maybe until. So there was an interesting goes on increasing until 5. Now it's getting close to 5. Now it's slightly decreasing. Okay. So 5 after 5:30 it decreases. So maybe due to sunset and it keeps decreasing during the night. So those are the observations. So those are the key observations that I'm seeing, okay? The times that it rises and the times it collapses, and the post-midnight observations, post-midnight spread. Those are the very major observations. So we are having a meeting. What minute and astute observations that we can have from here, and with those, what science questions can we pursue? Also, other major observations here are like these are moving, and Nathaniel says and common sense will tell like these are wiggling. So that could be a signature of wave activity, TIDs. Wiggling up and down, yeah. So is that due to TID? Like what's happening, okay? So how many days of data do we need? What parameters shall we be probing? What other sources of data should we be using? Those are the kind of questions that will set the research problem for me.
Now, one question I have for the group. Can we figure out a way to effectively get this sort of sounding mode onto the Tangerine SDR?
Just software.
Yeah, I know it's just software. But so I'm currently running this on an Edis N200. So of course, yeah, it's just software. I'm running it on an Edis N200. Which of course the Tangerine SDR is going to essentially have similar capabilities, so that will be fine. But then I have to run it over a gigabit Ethernet connection into a dedicated network card on the computer, and then, you know, for doing the automatic searching of the ionosonde signals, we are using a rather large amount of memory. And Yuha, who wrote the software, I don't think he has spent a tremendous amount of time optimizing the code, because that really isn't where his interest has been. He's come up with the basic algorithms. But I think if we're going to make this work on the Tangerine SDR, we're going to have to look at his code and figure out how it can be optimized to either work on the FPGA or we run it sometimes. Otherwise, yeah, so I'm just not quite sure how that's going to work.
Yeah, the FPGA on the Tangerine can do the processing. You just substitute a fixed frequency NCO with the linearly chirped NCO, mm-hmm. and then the output of that demodulator is the equivalent of what Yuha is doing in his code.
Mm-hmm.
The search algorithm, I don't know about. I don't know how Yuha does the search. There's a couple of options in Tangerine. You could set up 6 or 8 or 10 channels by implementing 6 or 8 or 10 chirped NCOs, and then you have 6 or 8 or 10 dechirped outputs. Mm-hmm. And if you can look at all of those in real time and figure out how to do searching, that's okay. If the searching is more complicated than that, for example, if there are hundreds of ionosondes that you're trying to find and you have milliseconds of timing offsets, mm-hmm. then that would probably overwhelm that kind of an approach.
Yeah.
Although I don't think that the search space is that wide in what's being done, in which case the FPGA can do it. The difficulty, of course, is if there's a narrow band RF source, you get those bright vertical streaks in the ionosonde data that mm-hmm. kind of corrupt it. And we talked a few months back, and there's a white paper about approaches to where the FPGA can use some spectral whitening to clean that up. And we had a lot of discussions that how to do it. We think there's a way to do it. But again, that's not real amenable to the search procedure. So
yeah,
knowing how search is working, that'd be kind of what I would guess.
Well, what one approach I thought might be possible is if you have a couple of, say, high-powered, high-performance receive stations that their job is basically to do the searching, and then they provide, they do the searching and then provide kind of a narrower search space that the more low-cost stations can go get information from off the internet. That could reduce the amount of searching a typical receive node would have to do.
Yeah, so the question I would have is, what is it that's being searched for?
Mm-hmm. I think, so in this case, I think in Yuha's broadest case, you give it the chirp rate that you're searching for. So in kilohertz per second. And then it's basic, the system's constantly looking for linear chirps at those particular chirp rates.
But these are very narrow, right?
These
rates are very narrow. I mean, they don't go over hundreds of kilohertz. They go over a very narrow little
bend. Yeah, we're typically talking 100 kilohertz per second, I believe, or, you know, maybe 150 kilohertz per second. Okay.
And 50 how, what's the extension of
the maximum is 500, I think.
And it ranges from about 2.5 to 25 megahertz.
Oh, okay. I misunderstood.
Right. So the number of variables is how many ionosonde stations are on the air. Do we know what time they're on? Do we know what their chirp schedule is?
Right.
Because if we know those things, we can cut down the dimensionality of the search space quite a bit.
Yeah. So certainly the locations of some of them are rather well known, and the chirp rates are of those can be rather well known. Like, we know the Virginia one, we know its chirp rate. What you don't necessarily know is the schedule. And at least for the Virginia one, the schedule seems to be consistent for a few days. And then they decide to, I don't know, restart the system or something. And then the schedule changes a little bit. So it's okay. Like you're good for a couple of days and then it changes. But that
you also don't know what the propagation will be like between you and the station.
That's
so
true.
You might see a section of the chirp and not the rest of it, right? Mm-hmm.
But
depending on the time of day and the MUF and, you know, propagation, you know.
Right, but do all the stations always, they're time locked to a time reference, are they?
Most of them, yes.
Okay, because if you weren't locked to a time reference, you'd introduce some kind of, you know, bias to the measurements and that you couldn't really resolve.
In fact, that's an assumption that Yuha makes. He assumes that all of the ionosondes that he's listening to start on a GPS pulse per second. Okay. And so then he uses that information to calculate the slant range from where, you know, the transmitters to where your receiver is.
But so why couldn't you use a broad band like, you know, a spectrum display like, from 3 to 30 megahertz, but not enough resolution to demodulate anything, but just like a spectrum scope, like they do on
most. Well, I think you can, and I think that's what he does now. But the problem is, once you detect it, then you do need the full resolution to do the dechirping. So you have to run like a ring buffer sort of thing.
Well, okay, but so you look at the wideband scope. And you say, oh, look, it starts on this time and it goes at this slope rate. And therefore, if I could set up an SDR channel where the NCO started at that frequency, at that time, and at that rate, you could follow it with the channel. And we've set this up so that you could actually have a, like I think Tom was suggesting, this is a chirp channel that you could set the parameters to, that you could actually program a channel in the Tangerine to follow a chirp transmitter, right, if you need the parameters. And so, I think you can get the parameters by listening.
Well, wouldn't the other idea, couldn't there be like a spotting couldn't we set up a spotting service? So when one of us detects something, you share it there, and then all the other people could listen to that.
And that would be very good, because the spotting service then would be an aggregate of all the receivers. So then even if you were in propagation range at the beginning of the chirp, you would know where it is, even though you might not be able to hear it. So you could tune your receiver to follow it. And then when it became in range, you would hear it. When it was out of range, you wouldn't, which is actually what you exactly want, isn't it? When can I hear it and when can't I hear it, right?
Well, I have a question. Do we really have to figure this out off the air? Are the folks who run the system not willing to tell us, give us information over the internet, over where, when
that is? That is questionable, because a number of these systems are Department of Defense. And so I've been told that, okay, even if you, let's say you did know the control room number, and let's say they did say that, you could call them up. If you are dealing with people who aren't U.S. citizens, there's potentially some laws that you're breaking, which you don't want to break. Yeah. So if we're able to serendipitously know this information, then we're not breaking any laws.
Well, we could serendipitously have our network of receivers that could build this database anyway, if we have enough receivers.
Yeah.
And then there's nothing they can do about that. We're not breaking any rules. We're just listening.
Right, which is,
It seems like the interesting part is to have multiple receivers listening to the same signal at the same time.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. With known locations for the receiver.
Yes.
Isn't that kind of required? If you don't know where the transmitter, you need to know where the transmitter is, though, don't you?
It certainly helps. Yeah. So
heard a signal sweeping by, and you have no idea. You might be able to figure out the rate and the frequencies it starts at, and whether you can hear it or not. But if you don't know where it is, what good is that going
to
do you?
Well, if you have a network of receivers, you might be able to do some sort of triangulation, right?
You could figure it out. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you consistently receive receive same kind of signal,
so that's another way to do it.
I'm just thinking in terms of the tangerine, we could use a broadband receive channel to look for them and then characterize them, and then we could build narrowband channels to follow them if we wanted to. I mean, right, Bill, we could have specialized, give me a stream that's a chirp stream as opposed to just a fixed frequency stream. And here's the parameters. Starts here at this time, sweep rate's this, that kind of thing.
Seems possible.
Right, so if I look at what information you need to decode the chirp, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't really matter where the station's located in terms of your ability to do the decoding. You either hear something or you don't hear something.
Mm-hmm.
To decode, you have to know the start frequency.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know the start time, and you have to know the chirp rate.
Yeah.
Right.
If the start frequency, Yuhad takes an interesting approach with. He just says you know what the chirp rate is, and then he just calculates a slope back down to zero, and he assumes that all of them start at zero frequency, even though they don't actually.
Okay. So you could make a simplifying assumption. That gets you down to a two-dimensional problem. Right, which is what time do they chirp and what's the rate of the chirp?
Yeah.
But you can't hear the rate.
If you have tangerine that where you could implement 10 or maybe even 20 receivers in a single receiver, that a couple of those would be able to cover a whole lot of that two-dimensional space.
That sounds good. And we can certainly, for beginning campaigns, you know, we can certainly identify known ionosons, and we could say, and with the known ionosons, we will know what the chirp rate is. So that's going to help things. So then the only thing that we're missing really is the schedule.
Yeah, the time of start and potentially the actual chirp rate.
But Tom, if you decode the chirp rate off of the receiver by looking at the rate of change in frequency, and they extrapolate back down to zero, then you could say, well, they started somewhere along that line. We don't know necessarily where, what frequency or time, but here's the frequency and time product, and here's the line down to zero. They have to be somewhere on that line.
And that's what Yuhad's code does already. In fact, But the actually the way his chirp, his dechirping algorithm works is, I think it doesn't matter whether you see signal down to zero or not. He still just assumes it starts at zero frequency, and he does the dechirping all the way from there.
Well, yeah. You're not likely to see the whole frequency range, right?
Unless
you're sitting next to it.
Yeah.
Right. So the key thing, I think, with Tangerine is, you know, we don't have the data bandwidth to move wideband samples from Tangerine to the host.
Yeah.
What we do have the ability is to program a bunch of different chirp oscillators to look at the results of dechirping with 10 or however many of the chirp oscillators will fit in the FPGA. And each of those produces a fairly narrow band stream, 20 kilohertz maybe, or 40 kilohertz stream. And we do have the bandwidth to move a number of those lower rate streams to a host. Mm-hmm. And then what we have to do is try to look at the number of start times and the number of chirp rates and see if we can find an intersection of those when a new one that nobody knows about suddenly pops up.
Well, Tom, one of the tricks that they do for the wideband scopes is they cut the frame rate way down. So you can't really demodulate it, but at what point how much could we cut it down and still be able to identify a chirp signal streaking across the spectrum? I mean, would we have to strip out all the useful information? Or?
Since the chirp is covering quite a wide amount of bandwidth, many megahertz of bandwidth, and doing it, in seconds of time, I don't know how readily apparent those would be in a wideband spectral display. That's a good question.
I've been able to see them watching. I can sit and watch a Kiwi SDR, and I've been able to see chirps go across.
On the wideband scope?
Mm-hmm.
On the 20 megahertz or so?
I don't know about the 20 megahertz scope.
Okay. So they're visually apparent then in a wideband scope.
Yeah.
You know what?
Well, you might be, if you had that, you would miss the ones that you first see, you would miss, but you would have the ability to say build up a database over time and then figure out the schedule and then start catching them.
Okay. So another option is to try and cover the whole space of combinations and then keep a log of who's on first, when they're there, and then update folks' receivers to modify their parameters based upon what was seen recently. So it sounds like there's three or four techniques that might work here.
Well, the one I was thinking of was to use the wideband scope to identify some streams and then use the narrowband scope to try and fit your chirp channels to one or more of those. And maybe you will be successful and maybe you won't, but it seems like and especially if you have a processor, then you can figure out, I guess, and you could do trial and error, I guess. I mean, you could get one off the broadband scope, decode it, say, well, I think it starts here and I think it goes at this many kilohertz per second, and let's hook up a broadband or a narrowband receiver and see if that's true, see if we see it. And then you might see it cross over your bandwidth but not be within the passband because you got the slope set wrong or the frequency's offset, then you never see anything.
Yeah, so there's a lot of ways that could be done. You could put four channels, each at slightly different chirp rates on the same frequency, see which one gives you the best result, narrow in. You could put three or four on slightly different start times and try to estimate which one's the right start time. So once you're close, I think you can come up with algorithms that'll climb into the actual. And for the other ones that you already know, the start time and the chirp rate, you just have to have a receiver rendezvous at that point at the right time. So these are all, I think, all possibilities that could work. I think the value of the Tangerine is you can implement multiple channels, each of which is narrowband.
Hmm. The thing is, though, if you want to dedicate the bandwidth of the the Ethernet channel just to this function,
you could get a reasonable amount of 0 to 30 megahertz data across. Now, no, your single board computer probably would not be able to be up to that task, but if you had a beefier computer, you could in fact get a 20 megahertz chunk of data that would be even demodulatable if you had enough horsepower.
Well, that's what we're doing right now.
Well, that's exactly. You're not taking the entire, like, say you want to go from 10 to 30 megahertz and decode all of it.
That is fire hose L mode.
That's exactly what we're doing right now.
Well, okay.
Why
couldn't you take that mode and decode your beacons out of that? You're not really losing any resolution by doing that.
Well, you can, but then you have to have a very powerful computer.
Yes.
And you know, what I'd really like to have happen is I'd like people to be able to run this on a modest computer, like the Odroid or, you know, I don't know, Raspberry Pi, but something much more modest than what I'm running on right now. And I'd also like them to also be able to still, you know, monitor WWV and monitor WhisperNet and do these other things at the same time.
So one of the things that you might be able to do is suppose that you took this broadband data, instead of just transferring it to the I9 that you're going to need to demodulate it,
yeah,
you let the FPGA do an FFT on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how narrow the bins it have to be, but past the PC, some kind of pre-processed data that it could relatively easily look in the bins and kind of figure out what the slope is and if it sees any of these.
Yeah.
And is there processing we could do in the FPGA that would make it easier for the single board computer to be able to decode these and not require a big beefy computer?
Right. And that's what I'm hoping we can figure out. I think some of Tom's ideas sound very promising.
Especially because we could already do narrow band with chirp with whatever slope you like.
Yeah.
That we got to figure out which ones to look at. So that's the hard part of the puzzle.
Right.
Frequencies to look at and what slopes to set.
Because the solution we have right now, Yuha's solution, which works, he's like, do the fire hose mode, get a big honking computer and call it a day. Okay. Yeah. That's great. I have a nice beefy grant. I can go buy myself a $3,000 computer and a $3,000, Edis radio here. But if we're going to have people, you know, spending $500 to $1,000 for a personal space weather station, they're not going to be able to do that.
But I kind of like Dave's idea then of how about a database that you can instruct the low-cost people that don't have I9s where to look, because they have cheap stuff. So
I do like that approach, because you know I could see, you know, funding an array of decent receive stations that can do the fire hose mode and just look at everything and build up a database and create an ionosphere spotting network. I could see that being effective.
There'll be some people who will want to spring for all that, but
yes,
not everyone.
Yeah.
Well, something else that occurred to me, I wonder if we could perhaps bring down the cost of doing the PC work by writing some code that would make the search algorithm run on a GPU, because if you can break down some of this work and parallelize it, it might be that the $300-$500 GPU that you use for video gaming, but a lot of times those can be cross-purposed, repurposed for scientific computing.
Yeah,
you might be able to get a $500 computer with a $300 GPU to do the big heavy lifting that you're currently doing.
Yeah,
and I think it's possible.
Yeah,
that some of the NVIDIA single board things would be able to do a significant amount of this for fairly low cost, certainly in that price.
A little careful about. Because, you know, you could spend $3,000 on a gaming laptop too that has that video system in it that you want. But, you know, MIPS are MIPS. Maybe the GPU MIPS suit you better and are cheaper. Maybe not.
I'm talking about the NVIDIA, the ARM single board computers.
Like the $100, $200 ones?
Yep. You know, kind of the top ends around $500 these days.
And how do those compare to...
Some of those have as much...
How does the video session compare to a high-end video card? Is that... Because you can spend $1,000 on a video card too, right?
Sure. You can spend a lot more than that, but, you know, for the ones that are dedicated to data processing, but they're not video cards. They're just massively parallel, you know, specialized devices. But the but some of these, like the NVIDIA, the Xavier and stuff, are I think the current main one has 32 gigs of RAM, has every kind of interface, you know, faster USB, faster Ethernet than anything else you've got in this system, and could be made to do the usual functions of the local host as well, without having to involve another large computer to plug it in, because it doesn't plug. It's a little freestanding thing, you know.
Yeah,
and they're very powerful. They're sold almost exclusively as AI development systems, but they're CUDA, little CUDA machines, and they, if someone wants to program it that way, they can do an awful lot of signal processing.
And they reside on the network, so you could use them as a coprocessor even. To
probably
yes. Or whatever.
Yeah. And we do have some example code by John Melton.
Yeah.
A lot of times the bottleneck on systems like that is getting the data in and out of them. The processing goes fast. It's loading the memory, then it takes a while. Then boom, it does a calculation and then outputting
the data. That's one of the reasons why the little integrated standalone systems, at least to me, seem like they would be interesting to experiment with, because if they are the local host and they also do, you know, you're already pumping the data, at least all around them.
Yes. So the options there I see is, can you, in the FPGA, reduce the wide bandwidth to the point that the resultant data rate fits easily on a gigabit Ethernet, so you can pipe it around your shack to such an instrument. So that's a third option here, possibly. I think Dave had a good point there before. You only need a couple of these, and then they can inform the army of tangerines.
I think it's really important to think of that scaling from you know, maybe on your grant, you buy some really high powered machines. You might have mid power machines for high end users and a whole lot of low powered machines that don't have the capability, but definitely can fill in holes.
Yes. Because Yuha said, as long as you know the information, it's relatively computationally inexpensive to do the dechirping, but doing the detection is where things take a tremendous amount of memory and work. But I do get the feeling that if we're clever about it, we can be more efficient than it is right now. And I do also know that the way, I think that comment about getting the data pre-processed in the FPGA so it fits easily over a gigabit Ethernet is important. Because right now with the system, I have a dedicated gigabit Ethernet going straight from the N200 to the computer with its own dedicated NIC without any switch in between, and I'm still saturating the line and dropping packets. So it's getting that down somehow is important.
So I have a question for Jules. I noticed he showed up. If we're done with this discussion,
Yes.
Sorry, I haven't answered your email, but one of the questions I had was, you said that the vertical connector and the horizontal connector have different pinout. Is that what did I read that right?
I'm sorry, you're referring to the vertical and the horizontal connector on which, on the boards?
Sorry, on the magnetometer board for the quick connectors.
Yes.
Oh yes,
that's correct. Yeah, they do.
Oh no.
Okay. Well, the problem is that the support posts that are soldered to the little pads that it would be normally in place for the horizontal connector invert the pin connections on the vertical connector.
Yeah, and of course it was designed for the vertical connectors using the horizontal pinout.
So right.
That makes them useless. Well, okay.
Jules patched it, didn't you?
Pardon me? Well, what I did for this one, since I'm not actually using the quick connector going to another board, I just reversed the order of pins on the leads coming from the quick connector for my scope, which I'm using just to monitor the activity on the I2C bus. So that was, but in the process of setting that up, I discovered the pin inversion. If you wanted to, you could actually take the vertical mount, solder it in the correct way, and use a couple of dots of epoxy to support it, to provide the actual physical support rather than those pads.
Because you wouldn't get the solder pads.
Right. Right. But you don't really, those solder pads for the support are only, there's no connection through them. It's just physical support.
Right. But you did also know that those same electrical signals are available on the PMOD connector too.
Yes. Yeah, I did see that. Yep.
Okay. Because what my thought is, I don't want to divert into magnetometer issues right now. And by the way, I still haven't sent that one out to you, Jules. I got it in a box ready to go. So I'll send it out tomorrow probably.
Yeah, but if you can do that. That's the one I'm making up for a magnetometer setup for Homan.
Is one enough? Do you need two of them, or is one enough?
One is fine. That's all I need.
Okay. And you don't need another magnetometer board, or do you?
Nope, I've got about three spares here.
Okay. Because my thought is on the Rev E board, when we do the final rev, and listening to all of the discussion, is if we were to lose the quick connectors, lose the PMOD connector, lose the external 5-volt connector and convert that to a fan power connector, move the RJ45 back to the exiting off the narrow end, but put it on the other end like Dave suggested, and center it so that it will then fit in a 1.5-inch pipe so that John will be happy. And then we'll put a header behind it with the connectors with the pins on it. So even though, Jules, you might get a board with the RJ45 on it, you'll still have a way to solder in or plug on your cable. And I think if we lose all those extra connectors over on the left side, there'll be plenty of room to do that. And it won't take a whole redesign. And I'm hoping if we leave the 40-pin connector on there and move the RJ45 toward the center, we will still fit in a 1.5-inch pipe.
Yeah, and even if I reverse the north-south axis on the board, it's fine because you can remap that from the data. It doesn't really matter.
Okay, so I don't have to change the orientation of any of the mag?
Nope.
Okay, just move the connector to the other side. And by the way, that connector housing is not steel. It's brass or bronze or copper or something plated. So
yeah, that'll work.
Yeah.
I'm all for that, what you're saying.
That okay. Sounds good to me too.
So it sounds like it addresses everyone's concerns. And then we'll have a fan connector on there for those who would like to relocate their fan somewhere, or at least their fan power. But so, John, since I think that was your request, I was just going to put a right angle 2-pin 1/10-inch center header on the edge of the board. Is that sufficient?
Yep.
Okay. And then, and add another address header for Jules to be able to do his three addresses on one bus.
Yeah, that'd be good.
And all that stuff's easy to do, but I'm going to wait until we're a little more mature in case there's anything else that comes up before we go off and change everything.
Of course, realistically, for the fan header, that's really going to be on a low-cost version, which I'm going to have built into my board.
Yeah, but other people have had asked the question is, how okay. do I power my fan?
Okay. So, if it's easy to do, yeah, put it on it because you just not populate it.
Yeah, because you could theoretically just plug your fan onto the power pins that are right there.
right? But
right.
But if you put it on right on the edge, maybe the cable, because you'd have to come up and then go down into the connector. But if you just come up and go right into the connector, you save yourself 3/4 of an inch of cable.
Yeah, the case I'm using, the fan, when I cut the leads off, has about maybe 1.5 to 2 inches of wire on it, which is just enough to wrap it around the fan and solder it to the protection diode on the Pi-4 by the input power connector.
But if you brought that up, well, you're not going to use this board anyway in your production.
Right, right.
But it would be enough to bring it up to the top, get it outside the case, and come in
if off the engine. I think it's the camera port. You would, if the connector was right there, you could probably get it to fit. Because it's a stretch to get it. Well, it depends on how you orient the fan. You can get more lead length out of it, depending how you
spin. You know, the board has a notch out of it for the camera port that's on the left side, because there's two camera ports. There's one that's buried in the middle of the board over by the over on the right-hand side, if it's oriented like our board's plugged onto it. And then there's another one over by the left-hand side. I guess one's a camera and one's a
video out, I think.
One's a video out. I don't remember which one's which.
Yeah.
But we actually notched the magnetometer for that cable.
Oh, okay.
On the left side. So if we put the connector right there, then sure. You're probably even going to have a hole in the case right there.
Yeah, that would work.
Got flex cable. So, okay. I'm just keeping notes for when it's time to do it.
At some point in time, Nathaniel, we're going to have to cross paths here. I got some logistics about stations and where things are going, and it looks like I got a couple of duplicates, but I might not. So,
yeah. Did you get the other email I sent you today?
Today? No.
Yeah, that'll be a fun one.
Hey guys, just to be clear, are we talking about using Raspberry Pi 4 as the core to this? Is that what we're building on?
A 3
starter with an N2, but...
Yeah, the 3B tends to run out of memory. So I have the 4 gig 4s, 4Bs.
That's what I've been using for development.
4 gig of 4?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And Dan, you used a 4 gig Pi 4 also, right?
I actually have an 8 gig.
So does the amount of memory
use 4 gig? So
does the amount of memory make that much difference once you get to 4 gig?
No, it doesn't make much difference at all. It might make some difference if we're using a 64-bit OS, but I'm really not doing that very much. I find that the Raspbian or the Raspberry Pi 32-bit OS is really a little bit better system than the Ubuntu 64-bit OS.
In fact, they just came out with a new version of the OS as of December 2nd, because there was a major kernel update for the Raspberry Pi Raspbian.
Yes, and one of the things they did improve was the video. It's much, much better.
Oh, excellent.
Now than it was before.
Excellent.
So, John, what the email I sent you.
Yeah, I'm looking at, there's a list of the distribution list for the magnetometers. Is that the one you're talking about?
No. Oh. So the ARRL Public Information Officer for Eastern Pennsylvania wants to do a TV show or a YouTube show.
And they
called What Hams Do. And so he wants to do one on HamSci.
Mm-hmm.
And so he wants something that he can do along with it. So I think the thing to do is have him actually set up a grape station and have him run it at his house. So what I want to do is I want to redirect one of the stations that we would either have you make one, or I'll redirect one of the ones that you sent me over to him for now. And then he can start getting it on the air and make this TV show out of it.
Yeah, because I'm seeing Jenny Jump was a K2MFF-2. And then there was another one that went to him as well directly at, I don't know, I'm getting confused. There was two of them that looked like they went to him.
To who?
Two Raspberry Pis on the shipping list.
Yeah, to whom?
K2MFF.
Yeah, so that's NJIT. So you sent those to whom?
Well, that's I've sent you three that you got today. One was node 14 is you.
Okay.
Node 15, I think, is going to Jenny Jump.
Okay.
And node 16 is without a reader because you said it was going to Veronica. Is that right?
Yeah. So have you been including Leo Bodner's in these?
I did on the other two, but not for node 16 to Veronica.
Okay.
Does she need one?
I mean, I have one. I have one here. So, I mean, if you sent me a couple already, then no, we don't need.
Well, the two one. I sent you are integrated into the Raspberry Pi. I mean, they're all integrated. It's a plug and chug.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
This is all set up. You provide an antenna and power, and you're good to go on an internet. You're done.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Either plug and play.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, that would actually be really nice.
But if you want me to redo the one for Veronica, that one did not include a grape receiver because you said you had a receiver. It has the audio card on it, but it doesn't have anything more than that.
Okay, I guess I didn't quite understand there. So maybe we do need to redo that one.
Okay, well, in that case, we need to talk then. We'll figure this out.
Yeah. So how about for this... How about for this guy doing the TV show?
Let me see. I got it right here. Jay Silber, WD2UAR.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
He had Frankie Bonte on there? Really?
Yeah. You need to watch this.
Oh my gosh.
See, I think this is really worthwhile.
Yeah, I set her up with that one too the last summer. Interesting.
So if you want, you can email Jay directly and
get his shipping address and all that.
Yeah, can you just send him?
Yeah, I can do that.
Yeah, so if you can email him and just tell him he doesn't need to buy anything.
Yeah.
All right, Dave. Thank you. 73. Yeah, if you can just contact him and be like, yeah, here's what you need. And come to our Thursday meetings. I already told him about the Thursday meetings.
Okay.
And then that'll get him the information he needs.
Okay.
And then he can just do a nice TV show about us.
Yeah, heads up on Thursday. I'm going to be late. I've got actually some eye surgery on Wednesday that I'm going for a checkup on Thursday.
Oh, good luck.
Glaucoma. It's a laser surgery. It's really cool.
Well, that's always a plus.
You're
the third person I know that's had eye surgery in the past month.
It's really cool to watch because it's a YAG laser with a frequency doubling crystal. So it's at a 1060 nanometer line, then it doubles to 530, which is bright green.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, this reminds me
of about 150 holes around the inside of your iris.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is where your eye is supposed to drain, but it gets plugged up, and that's why you get glaucoma. Or glaucoma. So they go in there and clean it out. And you sit there and stare straight and they go, and it's done. 90 seconds, it's over with. You don't feel a thing. But it's so fun to watch.
Of the engineer on the guillotine when it gets jammed, and he says, well, if you just take that rock off up there, it'll work fine.
I'll remember that Wednesday morning.
Yeah, I had a cataract surgery on Tuesday.
Really?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Change out the lens on this eye.
So they told me mine are growing nicely, but they're not up ready to replace them yet.
So you're back up and going in a week, Bill?
It's outpatient. It's done in 10 minutes.
Yeah, you're back up and going within 15 minutes.
Yeah, it's amazing. Absolutely amazing.
Yeah, you just have to keep up with putting the right drops in the right, lots of drops every day for a couple months.
Well, I've been to the dentist a lot recently, and I'm waiting for them to be able to grow new teeth because they keep telling me this is in the works, but I haven't seen any yet.
Well, I've seen where they're doing creating implants using a 3D printer of some kind.
Wow.
Yep.
So
when I got a crown put on, after they ground the crown, the tooth down, the dentist goes in with this wand
and they just slide up and down, and they take it in real time. It takes multiple photographs and stitches them together, and it beeps at you when it's got enough images to get a full picture, so then they know how to make the crown. And he says they make it off these visual images, and it's much more accurate than taking castings.
Wow. Yeah.
They have 3D milling machines, and I've had the dentist actually mill the crown from the computer database while you watch in the office.
Cool.
New teeth made while you wait.
And then they glue it right in. Then you're done?
Yep.
Yeah, they've had CAD or, you know, CAM milling machines for quite a long time back in the back of those labs.
I think this growing teeth thing is kind of like the 1,000-mile car battery, electric vehicle battery. You know, it's, you hear a lot about new this and new that, and you know, what is it? Lithium air. Now there's a new one. Lithium sulfur, I think, is a new technology. But you know, you hear that, and like it'll be 2030 before I see a battery that I can buy. Too bad.
Yeah, there's been some company that's been saying they've perfected a solid state battery. The problem with a lot of the lithium batteries, they use a paste, and that paste is part of the problem. So there's another company that's claimed the paste degrades, but there, and also it can freeze. If the battery runs down and it freezes, it becomes a brick. So now they've coming out with a solid state one that should not degrade. Oh.
You know, California passed their law that by 2040 or whatever it is, no internal combustion engine cars will be allowed to be sold in the state.
Yeah, there's a lot of countries setting that up, same regulation.
They figured out if all of the people in California were to buy electric cars, it would take three times the world's output of lithium to make the batteries to power these cars.
Yep.
That's just one state. So it's a little short-sighted to be tacking years onto things and saying mandate those.
Well, the bigger problem is the power grid to charge them.
Yeah.
It doesn't exist.
So look at how many millions of gallons are used in California, and then take that number and multiply it by 100,000 BTUs and divide it by the number of kilowatt hours in BTUs. There ain't no way they got enough generating capacity to generate that if everybody goes home at night and plugs their car in.
Yes, 3413 BTUs per kilowatt hour.
Yeah.
Not only that, but the east and west grids are at the Rockies are not connected. There was some legislation some time ago which did not permit that connection, which if it was there would allow a lot of power sharing that would take care of some problems we have.
And wasn't gasoline 100,000 BTUs per gallon? Is that about right?
That I don't know.
Seems to me it's like propane's 90,000 and gasoline's around 100 and. But if it's 100,000, it's only 3,500 per kilowatt hour.
3413 BTUs per kilowatt hour.
30, so it's 30 kilowatt hours per gallon. Is that right?
Yeah, you have to make your electric cars far, far more efficient than a comparable gasoline car, which they can do, but it adds cost, of course.
But there's only so efficient you can make it. I mean, it takes energy to move it from A to B, and that's you're going to spend that.
Yeah.
And the faster you want to do it, the more you're going to spend.
Yeah. A lot of cool engineering problems to work on right now.
Yeah.
Hydrogen.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that creates more CO2 than gasoline does. But got to start somewhere.
Yeah, it creates water, right? So therefore, you could. Just think about this for a second. Suppose you were a genius and you could develop a car that ran on water. You would cause more trouble in the world by increasing the world's demand for water than you could believe. Because we're already short on water everywhere in the world, pretty much everywhere.
Especially Phoenix.
Except you make your hydrogen out of electrolysis from seawater.
Yeah, you could do that. But that's what you'd have to do it.
Yep.
You could use fresh water.
So to interrupt you for a second, Nathaniel, the Note 16 that was going to go to Veronica needs to be redone with a receiver that I have, or a grape receiver.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that needs to get back to me then.
Okay.
Okay. unless you just want me to ship another one. What about the one to Scranton? Can I ship that to you? Because you have one on the list that's supposed to go to Scranton.
Yeah, that can come to me.
Okay, so if I need to ship you two, then you ship one back to me. That'll take care of the Scranton.
Okay.
And then I have, where did it go? Nuts. Can't find it when you need it. Seriously? No. I had it here and I lost it. Shipping. Tangerine. I'll type. One more grape. There we go. Okay, so we had Cal Poly, which is W6BHZ. And then there was Iowa State, W01SU or W0ISU, whatever. Then there's Scranton W3USR. And then there was NJIT K2MFF.
You're doing a good job taking over the world.
What's that? Impressed.
You're doing a good job taking over the world. I'm impressed.
Well, those
we might work ourselves out of the need for having tangerines at some point.
No, don't go there.
Well, here, what I'm hoping is that we start everyone off on the low-cost personal space weather station, and then once the tangerine gets like nicely developed, then we say, "Oh, you should upgrade here." That's what I want to have happen.
Okay, so Cal Poly and Iowa State are two I'm going to have to ship straight off. I think I can ship the Scranton and the NJIT one to you as well.
Okay.
And Veronica, so I owe you three then? Because I just sent you two.
I thought you
one
said
is
you
two and two. One is for Jenny Jump.
Right, but you're sending two to NJIT?
Well, that was the other one that was on the list. You had Jenny Jump and NJIT.
And who were you sending those to?
That's my question, because you have NJIT listed as K2MFF.
Right. And Jenny Jump is K2MFF-2.
Correct. So does he get two?
Who are you sending it to? Are you sending it to Hume?
Right now, the only thing I shipped with the three that I shipped are sitting in your office at school.
Right. Okay.
So node 14 is for W2NAF.
Okay.
Node 15 is for Jenny Jump, which is K2MFF-2.
Right.
And node 16 was going to be for Veronica, but you're going to ship that one back to me because it doesn't have a radio with it.
Right.
So I'm going to be shipping a node 17 probably for Veronica.
Okay.
And then node 18 for W3USR.
Okay.
And node 19 for K2MFF at NJIT.
Yeah, in Newark.
Okay, and then I have Iowa State and Cal Poly still.
Okay.
And then the last one would be for Bill Engelke.
Yes, and if you ship something to me, please use my address in QRZ. Don't send it to the university.
I will email you and ask you for the shipping address before I ship it.
Well, I'm good on QRZ.com.
Okay. I'll probably email it anyway just so I get it right.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me write this down because this is a complete changeover. So node 16 is coming back. Node 17 is now going to be Veronica, a full node. And I'll ship that to you, Dan or Nathaniel.
Mm-hmm.
Node 18 is going to be Scranton, or do you want that to be NJIT?
Doesn't matter to me.
Both of them are going to get a note by themselves.
Okay.
Is that correct?
Both of them are going to what?
Get a node? Get a pie?
Yep.
Or a grape?
Yeah.
So W3USR, which is at Scranton, will be node 18, and I'll ship that to you as well. And then the one that is at NJIT Can I send that to you as well for K2MFF?
You can send it to me as well. It actually probably would be better going straight to NJIT.
Okay. Oh, okay. So NJIT at K2MFF, ship directly. And then I have Cal Poly, which would be node 20. And I'll get the shipping address from someplace for that. And then node 21 is going to be W0ISU?
Mm-hmm.
And that is at Iowa State.
You can probably ship the one to NJIT to Gareth Perry.
Run that by me again?
Gareth Perry.
NJIT one.
Yeah.
Could you spell that, please?
G-A-R-E-T-H P-E-R-R-Y.
Okay, mine. Okay. So I can ship that one straight to him.
Yes.
So I got basically two coming to you with Veronica's full node and the W3 USR for Scranton. I'll ship Gareth Airy the NJIT one directly. Cal Poly gets shipped directly. WOISU gets shipped directly. And Bill gets shipped directly.
Yeah.
Node 22 would be
Gareth Perry, Kilo Delta 2, Sierra Alpha Kilo.
Kilo, ooh. Gareth, was that? Oh, okay. Who was that call sign for again?
Gareth Perry.
Oh.
He's a colleague of a Hyoman.
Okay. What was his call sign again?
Kilo Delta 2, Sierra Alpha Kilo. Because he does more with K2MFF than Hyoman does.
So that's where the node 19, the NJIT thing will be going to.
Yes.
Got it. I think I got it straight now. So I've got to ship two more to you. You got one coming back at me.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to ship four other ones after that. Okay. Other than that, I'm not doing much of anything. Okay. I think that should about run me out of nodes.
John, you said you were going to send me some code or something, and did you?
No, I did not.
Okay, because I've got to be careful because sometimes email coming to me, it gets lost by AT&T. So if I didn't get something, sometimes it just
Thank you for asking.
Went into the vapor.
I've been running 24/7 on getting these nodes done because I'm finally seeing the light at the end of the tunnel. Because once I get this done, then I can get the code, start working on the code for you to get it to Dave Witten as well.
There's no rush. I just want to make sure I didn't miss something that you said.
No.
Regarding the metadata for at least the
actually that code is running. I can send you a copy of that right now.
For the magnetometer. I'd love to see it.
Okay, I will send it to you. Do you have is your email somewhere?
It should be. I'm KD0EAG on QRZ. I've KD0EAG, just like on the sticker.
Do your email address is on QRZ?
Pardon?
Your email address is on QRZ?
Well, I have one through them that redirects, I think, but okay. I can just tell you what it is if you want.
Oh, okay.
It's WITTEND@WWRINC.com.
WWRINC, okay.
Uh-huh.
So it's WITTEND@WWRINC.com.
Yeah.
I'll send you a test email to make sure I got it right. And then I've got the setup program working. Now, this is intended for Linux system.
That's all I have.
Good.
I have
some. I said file protections and all that kind of stuff. But I'll send you that. And I just finished making a program that lists the information just as, and it puts it into a file if you want to read, look at it. So I'm okay. Working on it. But I'll send you that right away to start playing with it.
Yeah, well, because
that's the whole station.
Yeah, that's fine. All I really care about is the stuff that relates to the magnetometer. I don't know how you're writing this, you know, what it looks like. And that's why I want to see it. But I've come to the conclusion, at least for what we're doing right now, there's nothing for me, there's no good way to handle the metadata except to write a second file for each day, log that has the last, the most current settings, or maybe every time it restarts, even, I don't know. But
the way I'm doing it for the frequency data coming out of FL Digi is at the beginning of each day, the metadata goes as the header file to the CSV file. So it's an everyday CSV file.
Well, that's kind of, I'm writing an everyday CSV file, but if it gets stopped or interrupted in some way, which it shouldn't, but you know, it happens, it continues at, you know,
exactly appending.
And, but I was concerned that there might be different settings. The other thing is knowing knowing what to, how far to jump over the, you know, or how to read it intelligibly. And then I have a lot of settings that might be useful to have in there.
Yeah.
And I don't know
for that in what I call the metadata file, which gets tacked onto the header every day if you include it. That's all in that spec that's up on the web in the PSWS documentation.
Okay.
Where
is that documentation? It's you were talking about it being on it's on GitHub.
It's on GitHub.
Oh, that's good. And who's GitHub? Which one?
I think Nathaniel set that up. Did you not, Nathaniel?
I did set up a GitHub.
Yeah.
I have a GitHub for
what's the name of it?
I'll get to you in a second.
It's hamsci/psws_documentation.
Of course, here my pen doesn't write ham.
I'll put the link in the chat.
Yeah. But I've been keeping, in fact, the all of my utilities are up. In fact, the setup utility is already up there for you.
Okay.
It's all up there.
There you go.
And the only thing you have to do for Python is you might have to install the Maidenhead module. And I explain how to do that in my documentation up there.
Okay.
So basically just a pip add or pip install Maidenhead. And you're done.
And you're running
three.
And okay. Because we've got.
It'll run on two as well.
Yeah, but I want to do it like you're doing it, or, you know, I'm okay, because I'm working in C right now. I can always rewrite this in Python easily enough.
Talk to you because I want to be able to write in C the actual acquisition code to talk to the A to D.
Okay.
I have to look at hardware bits for my synchronization and stuff like that on the Pi.
For the A to D on the...
Now, this is an A to D that I'm designing in for the Gen 2 Grape. It's channel simultaneous sampling 16-bit A to D.
I see. Okay. Well, that's interesting. I'm not familiar with that, what you're doing over there. I've lost, you know, I don't have a full picture of what's going on.
Well, that's what I'm trying to get traction on, because I'm trying to get myself unburied from shipping all these things so I can get going on it. But the new clock module is going to save me a ton of work.
Yeah.
Because the fact they can generate the four frequencies.
Sure.
Yeah. And then
I'm happy to work closely with you on this.
Will send you the link and an explanation, and we can talk more about this later, and I'll get you up and going real quick.
Sure.
We can do a couple of Zooms if you want. Get you going, because it's all there.
Is there enough of it that I could put together some of the, you know, make something that looks like a great, well, I suppose I can't without
you. Well, actually, what I can do is the C code I wrote is actually the analysis module for FL Digi, and all of it's in there right now.
Okay.
I will send you that. Uh-huh. My code is heavily commented because I always forget 6 weeks later what I did. So
I know.
I usually comment the living crap out of it. So you can tell what code's mine, but it gets in there and it figures out it's the new day. And if it is, it writes off the new header file and the timestamps, and it creates everything. And on a 1 second epoch, it keeps writing stuff to the file.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm doing too. So with the, so just so.
I definitely want to work with you on that, because if I can get the hardware interface figured out in C for the A to D, that's the hard part I haven't figured out yet.
Okay, well, we can both bang our heads on that.
That's exciting, because as you probably don't know, I'm an analog design engineer and I do coding for fun.
Well, I'm a coder, but not maybe the, I had a lot of people who were better than me who worked for me in the past.
So. I know enough to be dangerous, but I'm not the kind of person who can start with a huge project like Bill has and just bring it all together and bring it all in. I don't have that background.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's a,
it's, it always amazes me, but yeah, that's what Bill does.
Yeah, yeah.
You're not there, Bill. You didn't hear that.
Well, you know, I've been doing it for 50 years, so
yeah,
I've got
the, so you know, that stuff like the back of your hand. It's just so like me in analog design. I get the stuff I take for granted for a lot of people, they don't even think about. So.
Yeah, that's an area that of a weakness of mine. When you get down into the electronics, I struggle.
Because usually what I end up doing on the development teams I've been on is I'll design the hardware and I'll get in and I'll write the low-level drivers that talks to the hardware, you know, the basic low-level interface subroutine calls, and I hand that off to the programmers to do their real job because they don't understand the bit banging of the registers and stuff like that. Like, they don't understand it. So once you get past that, you say, call this routine, set this up, and it does it. And that's where I've gotten my experience. So
I prefer to work at the just slightly on the software side of that divide too.
I'm one of those weirdos that likes to work in assembly language.
I I have moments when, you know, the black boxes just get so frustrating. I want to see every bit that moves. Yeah.
Yeah. Here, here. Bit level. Yeah.
Yep. I've done my share of coding like that, but it's been a long time. Gentlemen, I have to head out. 73, okay. Enjoyed it, and we'll be in touch.
73, Bill.
73.
Keep in 73. Touch.
Send some emails out to both Dave and to Nathaniel to make sure I got everything straight here.
Yeah, that'd be
thank
great.
Thank you for the help, and looking forward to this. This is getting exciting now.
Great.
Wonderful.
Well,
take care, everybody. Stay healthy.
You take care.
Yeah, indeed.
73.
73.
73.
David, what are some of the juicy details of your VLF receiver that you were working on?
Nothing fancy at this point. This is a rocket project that I'm working with John Bunnell at Berkeley with, the Viper mission. And he's going to be picking up NAA from the rocket.
Wow.
And he wants ground observations at the same time. And so we're putting we're working with Bob Marshall.
Mm-hmm.
Who's going to put receivers at Wallops and right next to NAA, and then I'm hoping to set up basically just an analog receiver. We've done digitizing once, but we just need amplitude information at this point to support the rocket. It's supposed to launch sometime this spring.
Oh, wow.
We'll see. Things have gotten pretty delayed at Wallops.
That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, all so right. We're using NAA in particular and whatever.